नमस्ते। देर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पीपल गो एब्रॉड फॉर वेरियस जॉब्स एंड विद वेरियस रीजन्स दे फॉल इन टू ट्रैप और वेरियस स्कैम्स एंड लैंड अप इन द ट्रबल। सो इन दिस वीडियो वी ट्राइंग टू आंसर द क्वेश्चन ऑफ दोज एस्पिरेंट्स हु वॉन्टेड टू सेटल एब्रॉड फॉर द वेरियस जॉब्स। सो वॉट आर द रूल्स आर देयर, वॉट आर द वेबसाइट्स दे नीड टू रेफर, what is their expected salaries and what is the average cost of living. These all the things we are going to discuss in this video, so stay together. Hi, this is Divya Prakash from nuclearmedicinesolutions.in, and today we have got a very distinguished guest, Mr. Madhusudan Vyas. He is a discipline lead medical imaging at Unitech Institute of Technology, Auckland, New Zealand. He is a content writer and editor-in-chief for statpulse.com. Currently, he is doing doctorate of health sciences from Auckland University of Technology. He is already MSc Zoology and MPhil Radiation Biology. He is a DMRIT 2002 and 3 batch and 18 publications to his credit. He has a number of honors and awards, including Society of Nuclear Medicine and Molecular Imaging, members of educators committee. So welcoming you, Mr. Madhusudan Vyas. Namaste.
Namaste. Thank you, Divya. Thank you for inviting me for this.
Yeah. So let's discuss first with the New Zealand, because you're currently based in the New Zealand. So what are the rules and regulations for the New Zealand country?
So New Zealand is basically, if I'll talk about the first, the nuclear medicine department or nuclear medicine, you know, community, it's very small. So we are like only 5 PET scan and total around 23 nuclear medicine department, and registered nuclear medicine technologists are currently around 54. So this is what actually the structure of nuclear medicine in New Zealand is. And how you can apply in New Zealand. So basically, as the regulatory board everywhere in the Western world, so we also have a regulatory board, which is called New Zealand Medical Radiation Technologies Board. And you can easily find their website while typing on Google, NZMRTB. And procedure. So basically, MRTB here works under the Ministry of Health, one of the act called Health Practitioner Competency Assurance Act. So they always try to work according to the standard which is set for all the other medical profession. Like if you're getting someone from overseas, so they should match the qualification criteria and also the practical experience, which is important one for us as a nuclear medicine professional or medical professional, I would say in general. So for MRTB, for nuclear medicine, you need to apply first to MRTB. So what is the application process for NZ MRTB is that you will go to the website. They have very easy process to follow. You need to apply for a registration expression of interest along with your all the previous transcript, your nuclear medicine qualification, which you have received from whichever university, because in India now, for example, we have Manipal, PGI, Chandigarh, All India Institute of Medical Science, and I think Lucknow SGPI also giving Masters of Science in Nuclear Medicine.
Yes.
And then PGD MRIT as well. And unfortunately, our courses are not in the listed universities, because if we look at the structure of the education, which is already approved by MRTB, and they don't need to go through the pre-registration exam process, have 3 years of graduation study plus 1 year of clinical placement. So they actually don't consider directly to us, but it doesn't mean they do not consider. I'm sitting here, there are two more Indian origin technologists currently working in New Zealand. So the process is, once you apply, then for all those country, not in India, including India, there are a few more, you have to go through a process called registration examination assessment. So basically what they consider, that 3,600 hours of clinical experience post qualification you have, but still you need to go through first a pre-exam, which is REA, resident examination assessment, which gives you three chances to pass, and you need to achieve around 70% in certain domains. So if I'm calling domain, that means how's your communication skill with the patients, how's your basic understanding about the nuclear medicine processes. So that is RE exam, and not only nuclear medicine, for even general radiography, MRI or radiation therapy, for every practice you need to go through first that exam. Once your REA pre-exam got clear, then you will get a 12 months expiry letter from board, which state that now you got the first layer cross. Now you need to find a recruiter who actually can assess you, help you to be assessed practically by MRTV. So basically you need to apply for the job, and you need to tell that you got a REA condition on the registration and you already passed the exam. So once you finish that, then you, if somebody is happy to take you, like I got the same similar condition of REA, then for 3 months you work in that particular department, and we call it familiarization period. Like you get familiarized, you know, different country have different rule. So you get familiarized, you understand the protocol of their department, how to process, how to communicate, how to take consent, all those theory to practical. You will go through that 90 days training under the supervision of the senior tech who's working there. And then you will be assessed by board's registered assessors. They come and do check your process from hot lab, then how you acquire, how you do the quality control process, how you take the consent. And then there are certain questions they ask as well. So it's like a two-layer process. Previously, it was one layer. Unfortunately, from this year, the process has entirely changed. Reason, because nuclear medicine degree wasn't available in New Zealand previously. So that's why they were totally relying on overseas qualified technologists. But because the University of Auckland has now started providing those postgraduate diploma or master's in nuclear medicine. And good thing about that course is that those qualified radiographer who finished their graduation radiology, they can do that course in 3.5 years, and recruiter always support them. So this is actually, you can say we already got a plan B ready. That's why overseas qualified candidate have to go through that two layers of qualification. So this is for the nuclear medicine or any medical radiation science professional, even somebody who is actually following your channel for general radiography or MRI, they have to follow the same process.
Means I just wanted to know, if someone is in India and he wanted to apply, so the first registration on the website, the exams, all those exams will be on online only?
Yeah, that will be online exam. And basically we use an artificial intelligence based system, which actually monitor your screen if you're not doing anything. So it's like you don't need to go to Singapore or Malaysia for that exam. Okay. But you can do that at your home. And once you have done that, then you will be applying for the job, because you will get like one layer you cross, and then you will be applying for the job. And your recruiter should be aware that you have a REA condition. So you're not full registered yet. You are still having a registration examination assessment. You've done one layer clear, but you have to clear the practical assessment as well. So theory you can give from home online. Okay. And then you will coming to New Zealand, like your recruiter will support your visa. Then you will work, and also you get salary as well for that. Okay. And the good thing is that once you pass that exam, you will be actually get your salary hike straight away. So immediately your results is get, your salary will be increased. Second, your fees of the exam, which is $2,800. Previously it was 2,000, but now it's a $2,800, which in Indian currency, I think around 150,000 rupees. So that exam fees for the practical assessment I'm talking, okay? Not for the theory one. So the practical assessment, that whole fees, whatever you have paid, once you got registration, they pay back to you. This is the condition.
Okay, and all our qualifications from the Indian universities, Indian education institutes, they are all valid for the entry.
Valid for entry is a tricky word, Divya. It's actually valid in the terms of like it. They consider like how many, like 2 years qualifications for most of the, or even DMRIT only 1 year. So if you look at the University of Sydney, Charles Sturt University or Melbourne University, which actually have a 3 years graduation in nuclear medicine and following by that 1 year of clinical or PDY. So after 4 years of qualification in graduation in nuclear medicine, then they get registration. So what if, how we can compare ourselves, you know, in comparison of a 1 year degree or 2 year degree. So what they consider in our qualification, they know that these are the qualification provider and you, but they also want to get a good, you can say, picture of your clinical experience, that you have a good, you know, clinical experience or not. And also, honestly with you, they evaluate everything case by case. So that's the process. But it's pretty much straightforward. 3,600 of clinical hour, post your qualification. And also you need to send when you apply everything in detail, what you have learned in your all 2 years of qualification or 1 year of qualification, what was actually in your radiation physics you have learned, what in the anatomy, what kind of scans, or all range of scans that you have learned, practical radiopharmaceutical training, technical training. So then they evaluate against the available program that we have here. This is what the process is.
So is this process the same for the Australia also, or this is only for the New Zealand?
It is same for Australia. The only painful part in Australia is that even after the qualification, you got registered, you have to go through a 1 more year, which is less salary, that is called PDY, Professional Development Year. So basically, even you cross the REA sort of exam, they call it pre-registration exam there. They recently upgraded their whole manual. So I'm being part of that. So I know, because society actually keeps sending information to us. So that's publicly available document. So they change a little bit, but it is the same. Australia was doing actually same, but New Zealand recently acquired that.
Okay. Okay. And what would be an expected salary for a fresher? And this 3,600 hours of training, which you have said, that is applicable for everybody. Means for the fresher or 5 years experience or 10 years experience like that, is that does our experience does count there, or it is called as a fresher that you can train?
So 3,600 hours of clinical experience. So that means definitely we are not looking at the freshers, obviously. If you look at like you working 40 hours per week. Yeah. We are not working 40 hours, honestly. We are working Monday to Saturday. So 8 hours. So you can consider in that way, like you're working 8 hours per day. So 48 hours multiply by 52 and some holidays you can take out. So this is what their calculation is. So obviously these countries are not looking for any fresher. And so you can see like two, and even, you know, this is some first time I'm interacting about this topic one-to-one on some live channel, but most of the nuclear medicines technologists who are in my LinkedIn, or I run a small NMB group, which I'm still staying connected with my gurus from RMCs and all my friends and from nuclear medicine in India. And they always ask this question, that what the requirement is, and should I apply now, like fresher? Say, I said, no, at least 3 to 4 years of experience if you take, and then you will apply, then you will be in the better situation. Okay. This is what actually, okay. Yeah.
Okay. So roughly around 3 to 4 years of experiences would be required. And
yep.
There you will be counted as starting as a fresher.
So let's come back to the nuclear medicine in New Zealand, if I say. So we have a system here that is called District Health Board or Public Hospital, and also we have private practice. So I got a job in public hospital, but then I'm currently working in private and also working in Ministry of Education. So I'm like involved in that. But basic system works as a DHB or District Health Board, we say. So we have around 16 DHPs, and they have a system for MRTs, or medical radiation technologists, we say. So we have a label system. So for example, if you're qualified here in New Zealand, you've done your graduation in general radiography, for example. So you will be appointed as a level one,
okay.
Then level two. So first appointment will come as a student MRT, then level one, level two, level three, level four, level five. So for next 5 years, you don't need to apply for any promotion other than you've done something very big nonsense. Then it's a thing. Otherwise, your appointment will happen. Your promotion will be from level one to level five will happen. You go straight, and your salary will also increase accordingly.
In each year, it will be promoted.
Each year, level one to level two, level three, like
okay.
that.
Okay.
After that, level five, level six, level seven, up to level 10, you need to apply every year for the promotion, or you will be evaluated according your achievements. So this is what actually system works. And every level have a different salary slab. And that salary, we have a union here that we call Association of Professionals Executives. So that is called APEX. So they actually are basically old senior MRT or some lawyers, or they actually, you know, highly professional who work some as a CEO. They just work as our voice, and they go and do some negotiation with the Ministry of Health, and they decide what the salary should be and what should be the hike. And how you can achieve leadership positions. So senior MRT we call here. So that comes from the level seven. So that's your senior positions. And then 8, 9, 10 become the team leader, and then rest of our managers and all that thing you can achieve.
In each year, do we need to undergo some examination, or it will be time bound
promotions? No. It is up to level five, it will go like this only. And one more thing which I just want to highlight here, Divya, that in India, we just got the qualification, and we just go and we work 9 to 5. Yeah. That's it. Yeah. And we don't need to do any kind of a license apply. Like, you know, we apply for the license here. We apply for the license every year for the renewal. And what is actually call it annual. So once you got registered, it doesn't mean that you are not doing anything. You will be audited every third year by board.
Okay.
So every year we apply for a annual practicing certificate. So what is annual practicing certificate? It's a very beautiful concept. Annual practicing certificate basically is the a kind of a mutual agreement between you and board that we are giving you 12 months license to work as a NM professional or any XYZ professional. And as per HPCA, Health Practitioner Competency Assurance Act, I will take care that I will follow all those rules, like taking care of the privacy of the patient, and also will work on my continuous professional development. So I have to do certain clinical, CMEs. I have to go to the conference. I have to publish something. I have to read some journal. And then I have to write that how I'm going to use that work in my professional world. For example, you've done a PET CT conference, you learned something in melanoma positioning. So you went back to your department and said, okay, we are doing wrong. I learned something. So you need to just write a reflection on it. So this is something which actually, and you have to keep that evidence. And we, as a society member like ANZSNM or NZIMRT, we keep our account there, and we always update those substantial
those things
CPD hours. Yes, these are
online applications.
And everything. And then you have to provide it. And then every 3 years, you will be selected randomly by board. And you have to provide all those evidences to board that what I have done and what I have said in that application, I was making sense to it. It's real.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And what is the expected salary now? if you're not comfortable, we can leave.
No. That's perfectly fine. It's not a thing which is actually hidden.
Okay.
No, that's fine. So basically, if I say about the salary,
it's for the fresher, the one who joins there.
So again, fresher word is something is not
there
right. It will not be grade one. Honestly, with you. When you will come with that much of experience, like 5 or 6 years, depend on the recruiter. They sometimes can put you on directly on level five. Okay,
they
level
can
six.
put it.
But
There is a
yeah,
provision.
but there's not a provision. But the thing is that when they will invite someone from overseas, so you have to go through the immigration process,
yeah.
And then New Zealand immigration will ask, or any country immigration will ask, okay, what is the reason you are not actually acquiring someone from here? They say that this is the long process and we have to go through. So they have to give 100 reasons. And then the good thing about the Western world that they always understand that what is the minimum salary requirement to run a life with a dignity. This is very important. So that's why they have to give a minimum salary as per the law that they have. If you're inviting someone, have to give that much of salary. If somebody's bringing their family over here, their kids over here. So those things are need to be assessed by the immigration. And then once your offer letter will go, your New Zealand immigration will check it. And that has to be like in the range of what immigration said. Otherwise, they can put a question mark. They said, how you will survive there? It's not possible for you to survive. And another problem is that the taxation is very higher. Like it's a 34%, which is the highest range. And there is no ATC, ATD, ATE system here that you can save your income tax. Yes, everything you have to pay. And okay. So the thing is that that's whole calculation comes in the picture. So that's why I'm saying that salaries will be there. But you know why people come? Because there is a life. This is okay. Important thing. You have to have a work-life balance. So that's my diplomatic answer for your salary question. And what the salary range are. So that depends where you are working, in private or public. But still, I mentioned there is a range. So for example, you appointed as a level 5 technologist. Okay, so salary of yours will be level 5 or level, so that will be in the range of 75,000 per annum to 80,000 New Zealand dollar per annum. That will be the salary. So if I say per hourly, they because here they pay per hourly, so you will be getting per hours. Okay, so 75,000 to 80,000 New Zealand dollar will be the salary per annum, and then it keep going up to level 10 cross 110,000 or something like that. So I can't give you the exact number because it's a different contract have different, and salary is something which is quite important part for everyone, woman or man, whoever it is, they tell their salary, but this is what actually the range, and that goes in this way. And one more thing you need to understand that due to the APEX, which is our union, they always make sure that according to the inflations, according to the current market situation, your increment should go every year. So salary, whatever I'm telling you right now at 7:28 p.m. as per New Zealand time on 8th of October, this range is this, but next year this will be different. So it change every year, but salary is always justified according to the your family, whom you're bringing. So all those stuff actually works.
This all gets counted. Okay. So this takes every, means if you're going as a bachelor or if you're going with the wife or with the two kids, so
yeah.
These structures will be different, or it's the same for, means you are going there as a candidate and your family is your liability as per my understanding, not their liability.
Yeah.
So they count your liability also while estimating your salary, or just they give you, or means will you be able to save some money there or not if you're going with the wife or two kids?
Honestly, Vidhi, if I don't want to bring the race part here, but if you are not eating outside, important thing is, and if you are race, why I've said, because you can understand what I'm relating it, because
yes.
There's some people have a nature of saving, some people doesn't have, okay? And also, what is your way of living? If you are going like out, you have a pub you want to go pub out and you want to have some alcohol on weekends. And so alcohol is quite, people expensive. Drink a lot here. Yeah, but everything is expensive. And New Zealand comes in top three or top four. Everything, we just open the beer. I don't drink, but I'm telling you. And so it depends how your lifestyle is. So okay. I cannot generalize it.
It is, yeah, with an average
lifestyle. And the good thing, and also one more thing, Divya, that it is important where you are living. Like if you're living in Auckland and you're living in Wellington and you're living in Christchurch. So these are the three main cities of New Zealand. So Auckland is very costly, honestly with you. Like the rent of the house is like, you can say start for a family house of a two bedroom with a garage and everything. Start around, depends which area you're living. South Auckland you're living then or North Auckland, wherever. But its range start from $550. Per week. So that's, I'm telling you, it's a good quality house, and good quality house is important because these, this is something which is good for your health as well, right? So that's the Auckland. But if you're going to Wellington, again, the rental property is quite higher. That goes around $600 per week. That's the starting for the two bedroom house. And if you're going Christchurch, that's the quite 450 to 500. These all data based on the TradeMe or some local website, I'm telling you, are also based on my experience. So it depends where you are living and also where you, how much you need to commute. For example, in Auckland, you need to commute a lot. From like my workplace where I'm currently living, my one workplace is 45 minutes away from it, because the driving is quite hard because the traffic is so much in Auckland, not like Mumbai or in India.
Traffic is also there a problem in New Zealand.
I know Auckland is a big problem, traffic, because the
because in India only.
No, it's a problem, man. The problem because in the peak hours, you will find a quite kind of a very hard to, you know, commute. And also there's a speed limit. So if you like crossing 100 kilometers a speed and you captured by 105, so you will be getting a ticket of $140, okay. Which is so it's too much. So cost of living in Auckland is quite higher. Wellington slightly less, but not lesser than Auckland. And Christchurch is quite higher. So if somebody's getting position in Wellington, for example, so it's very easy. You can walk. While I was in Wellington, like I worked for 3.5 years in Wellington. So I was easily walking for my first 2.5 years. I used to ride my bike because just 3 streets away from my hospital. But then when moved my, I bought a house and we went like almost 25 kilometers away from the place. So then I started realizing, oh my God, it's hard even coming from one motorway and entering to Wellington. So every city have their different challenges. And according to that, your savings and your, you know, what you can do with that money which you're getting in. So this is important. And if somebody is married, I always encourage that your partner, or partner is not a word in our in from India. So you need to be aware that your wife is actually a professional. That would be great, because if you both of husband, wife, or if the female tech and her husband is actually having some professional degree or something they have done or some experience, so that visa, that dependent visa that you will get, you'd be able to do some work and can earn some dollar. So it will be a kind of a good contribution, you know. Otherwise, it's easy. Your kids' education will be quite free, and a health for up to the age of 16 is free for the kids. So you don't need to pay any bills. You can go straight to any. Yeah. So these kind of benefits.
Your taxes are being used somewhere for you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's why we are happy to pay that.
Okay. Great.
Yeah.
And so are we done with the New Zealand, I think? Or anything else you wanted to tell about the New Zealand?
I think the best thing I would say to your listener, that please make sure that you just look at the website, MRTB website, and you can, they are very friendly. You can email to them if you have any query. I think
they
that's
reply.
The best thing.
They reply.
Yeah, they reply. MRT@medscience.co.nz. They reply very, very much. Actually, their staff is working for this only.
Okay. And let us move to the Australia. So anything extra do we need to do for the Australia, or we have already covered?
We covered New Australia, New Zealand is the same. So remember one thing, we are like a brother-sister. So what Australia is doing, and we almost in the same boat. So that's why Australia and New Zealand Society of Nuclear Medicine work together.
work together.
And yeah, and we have more Australian tech here, and then few Canadian, and then few Indian.
Okay.
Yeah.
So next, which country would you like to go? Because in my list, I have Gulf countries, USA, UK, Europe, Canada, like that. So which country would you like to go now?
Tell
If
me,
there are
actually,
any advantage.
due to COVID and due to the border restriction, I want to go anywhere.
Okay, so let us go to the Gulf countries first, because from India, the people used to go to the Gulf countries and then try to, for the other countries. So what about the Gulf countries rules and regulations?
Honestly, I never applied for the Gulf countries, but I can tell what exactly their process is. So they are quite in, we can say, affected or inspired by Canadian and American system. So previously they were considering 3 years qualification or certain amount of experience, and you remember they just come and do the recruitment process in metro cities and you just apply for that. So their understanding comes from the Canada and American base. So in
They have
America and
their
Canada, what
system.
they,
Okay.
yeah. So basically, in Canada or America, what they have a college system. The word college is coming from America, but here college is different in the British or Australia, New Zealand. Here the high school called college, but in America or Canada, they call college, like we call college for graduation. So there's they actually call college of two, and they also have a similar type of qualification that we have in America and Canada, 2 years postgraduate qualification for nuclear medicine, some certifications program, and they have a pathway. You can find on SNMMI website that recently one of the forum worked on how to transform someone who's qualified as a graduate in radiography or graduate in certain and what pathway they should use to get qualified as a nuclear medicine technologist. So they actually considered at least minimum 2 years qualifications and then at least 5 years of experience. If someone is lucky, fresher can go, but fresher is actually always, I say, do not apply until you have a good amount of experience in your
Your
CV.
respective profession.
And yeah, obviously, because that and more prof you are quite experienced, Divya. You know that when you got qualified and now you can feel that difference, you know. This is
Obviously.
something that we learn every day. So this is the one A thing. So this they are quite inspired from them. Second, every single Gulf country. So if you say Gulf country, so they have Saudi Arabia different in the Middle East, Dubai and you know Doha, those are different. So they have their own regional health board.
Okay.
And the yeah, and most of those regional health boards have a criteria, so they will acquire you. You don't need to apply for any registration or something if they found you they're suitable. But once you reach there, then you need to get the registration of their local health board, and they also ask you to apply for CMRT, like Canadian Medical Radiation Technologist Board,
So once we reach there,
or
then once we reach
yeah,
there, then
they
their
absolutely.
qualifications examinations has to be taken up. So that
Yes.
means they recognize our qualifications,
Yes,
and
I would say yes, they recognize. They recognize.
based on their recognition, they invite you for the job, and then once you go there, you need to apply for their certifications.
Yes, and one more thing, Divya, that I would like to say to your listener that you know there are a lot of scam happen on the Middle East side, and so people just like consider them as themselves as an agent, and they just do the recruitment process. And there's a very easy you can create any website. Okay, so always apply for the Ministry of Health related job because that is
That is
more
very important.
stable.
Yeah.
That
Yeah.
is important. Don't apply for any private recruiter and waste your time in it. So that's the important thing. So go to any website which is actually quite you know, you if any doubt about the recruiter, you can check that. Even you can complain to immigrations as well, because that can happen to any country. So always apply in Gulf and Middle East, that is Ministry of Health, if advertising that position.
But private hospitals also advertise, like Hamad, and means there are a number of big hospitals.
These are quite big names. So like
And
King Fayyad Hospital, I'm
in my
saying that.
experience, I have seen that they go for private recruiters only.
No,
And
they ask for the private recruiters. Obviously, they cannot send their people over here. But what I'm saying in very beginning that it's very, very important that you check where you're applying,
checking,
because
yes.
there, yeah, because you know you really don't know. You
Yes,
go
yes.
there and you will be in the trouble. And they
Obviously.
always so I don't want that this thing happen to anyone in future, because it's very hard. So this is something they need to take care, and qualification is definitely they consider. And following off that, you need to go through certain exam that they will ask you to complete. And honestly, in Middle East and Saudi Arabia, if I go randomly, I will find most of Indian doctors and Indian technologists are
Yes,
working.
yes.
So it's very easy passage. And I would say that try to find someone on LinkedIn who's working in those centers and questions. So LinkedIn is something which is I always prefer.
Connecting to
Like
everyone. Yeah.
yes, and it's a very good platform. And you can find someone, you can request someone, you can message someone. If you have any question, you can ask them. So it's a very good process, and it's like you're, you know, leaving curriculum. It's like you're leaving. You're updating your CV, you're updating bio data, and you can share. And even currently, recruiter asks for your URL of the LinkedIn, so you can send them and they can have a look. So I would suggest if somebody's listening your channel, that make sure you go to LinkedIn, create your profile, and make your profile presentation quite stronger. Build your network and find people who are working. Even somebody want to connect with me on LinkedIn, I have many actually a LinkedIn connection in the Middle East who are working currently as a doctor or tech. So not me, even you can find hundreds like me who are actually having. So this is what the networking is. So that would be the best thing. Talk to real people who are working there, and they will tell you the real information. Nobody will hide. If somebody's hiding, I think this is not right.
Yes. Okay. And regarding salaries part, I think they give like house and all there, so they provide along with salaries.
Yeah, so this is something which is important. So salaries, so obviously Saudi Arabia
Yes,
or
I
Gulf
think it is
countries,
good salary they provide.
so salaries are like in the range of, if I can give you range, they declare, but it's in 25 lakh to 30 lakh per annum. That's what they do. So there's no tax there. So you will be getting
Yeah.
complete salary in your hand. And following off that, you will be getting some money to coming, depend which who is your recruiter. You'll
Yes.
be getting some amount to travel back to your home country and coming back. So you're getting certain holidays, that kind of their package that they always give. They provide houses, they provide accommodations with a fully furnished accommodation, I would say, in a generalized way, instead of going too much of bits and pieces. But one thing which I would say that you need to be aware of, that lifestyle. So it's quite hot, quite humid, quite hard temperature, but for us, we are used to it, so that's not a problem. Otherwise, it's a good working place, good working environment. And the good thing is that if somebody is applying in Gulf countries, even you forgot about the Singapore also recognize our qualification
Okay.
and with the experience. So they have their regional board as well. But this is also another option they someone can consider. And these places, Gulf and Singapore, if you take some overseas experience, these are like approved clinical practices. And you can use this as a jumping pad and go to the Western world. Like somebody got a CMRT registration in Gulf, you can apply in Canada straight away, right?
Yeah.
So this is something, the pathway someone can use to if they want to go to Western country further in US or Canada.
So there are two questions. As far as my knowledge, the Singapore is a very expensive city, and getting a job and just using as a platform to switch somewhere else, that would be okay, or doing a job and living there is also okay for the Singapore.
So basically, Singapore, if you say, like, I never lived over there. I only know that this place can be considered. About the costlier part, so I think I am living in one of the costly country and the city in the world. So not costly than here. What is the weekly rent? So I remember when I was applying in there's always a vacancy available, but in I applied once in Singapore while I was in India before coming to New Zealand. That time in 2013, I done a little bit of research. So 8 years, everything has changed, but the rents are quite cheaper. But those rents are in the form of studio apartment, 2 bedroom or 1 bedroom. So every country have their different challenges, and I think the best thing people can do there is ask questions where what is the a living standard or cost of living, all those answers are available. So I have no idea, so I don't want to step in anything which I don't know. I only use Singapore airport, which is one of the best, and you can do good shopping over
Okay,
there.
great, great. And then the second question was, you just said that the accommodation and other things are offered in the Gulf countries. Like that, is it offered in Australia and New Zealand also, or
No.
just they offer the salary?
They just offer the salary. Be ready for it. I'm
Okay.
very clear.
Other things
But we,
you have to arrange by your own.
yeah. So basically, first 2 3 weeks, you will get some accommodation
They
support.
will assist you. Okay.
Yeah. They will assist. Like when I came here, obviously I got accommodation for 3 weeks, and I was staying with one of the doctor. I haven't came with my family for first 6 months because there was some marriage at home. So obviously that's a personal reason. But when I came, I have stayed with a doctor. He provided his like he's having a kind of a house with a bottom and underfloor something he was providing to me. You can stay here in one room. So
It was a
that was
personal
paid by.
arrangement, or it was from the
No, no,
organization
no, no, no.
itself?
It was arranged by hospital. So for 3 weeks, I got time to find some accommodation.
Okay.
So then I found a website that's called TreadMe, and you just need to find a flat mat. This is Western world, and you can actually go straight and can say you're new to the country. People are very welcoming. In new Kiwis are very welcoming. I'm also Kiwi now, I can say. So we welcome people here, very warm
Okay.
hearted, and I was accepted very well. I got like within 2 weeks my accommodation, and then I changed almost to accommodations. So, but yeah, I'm like this is what happened, and it's very clear that you will be getting 2 to 3 weeks accommodation. If you're having trouble, you can approach to your manager, and they can help you, and they can find some accommodation.
Okay, and
But you have to pay.
everything you have to buy, means from scratch, everything you have to buy and then arrange everything.
Yeah, you have to. This is what I want to be clear on it, that don't keep any false dream in your mind or false hope that you will be getting a king size house here. No, you have to do everything by yourself.
Everything by
So you,
yourself, yeah.
everything, yeah.
So do they pay some advance salary, because in going in that country and purchasing everything will be very expensive for a newer person. So do they pay some advance salary to buy your stuff, or you have to carry that much of money from your home
I
just in
think
case you
the
need
best
help?
idea should be you carry some money in your hand. Like when I came, I just actually assumed that I have to carry at least expenses of 3 weeks in my hand. So this is what I inquired with my manager, and his salary comes after 2 weeks. It's not monthly. So you will
Okay.
be paid quarterly. So my salary came after 2 weeks, and I was able to cover that expenses. But at least keep 3 weeks salary in your hand. That 3 weeks expenses in your hand, and there is a rough calculation, Divya, is that if one person need to have at least or be ready for the expenses of $2,000 per month if you are very lazy and you want to eat outside. So takeaways, dinner and lunch is quite costly. It costs now $60 at least, and if you eat outside, bill will come $150 to $200, which is in India is around 10,000 rupees. So need to be ready for those kind of expenses. Who would like to cook when you come here, right? I was eating samosa for 3 days. Yeah, there was an Indian restaurant was there, so I just wanted to taste how the New Zealand samosa tastes like.
Okay. So roughly in Indian money, if I estimate, it will be around for per person around 1 to 2 lakhs rupees they need to carry.
Yeah, absolutely.
More
And
than that, yeah. For
yeah,
per person,
and
if you're coming
there.
with 3-4 person, you need to have around 7 to 8 lakh rupees or
Yes,
five
and
lakhs.
make sure that the money you are carrying with you, it shouldn't be, you can't carry cash more than $10,000, equal to $10,000. So that's the criteria of the traveling. Okay. So the best thing is that you should have a NRE account, or Bank of Baroda actually operates here, and most probably in international countries. So New Zealand have two branches of Bank of Baroda, one in Wellington and one in Auckland. So you can make a travel card from them and you can encash your thing. And other thing that you can do, if you want to carry cash, or so then don't carry much more than $4,000. That I would say that's more than sufficient. And the best thing always should be that don't bring your family in the first 90 days REA part, because it's quite uncertainty, because there is who knows that you failed, you are going back. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of thing that you are unsettled. Everyone who knows someone's wife or husband is already working in a good, stable condition, and you just say, oh, resign, I got an offer from New Zealand, but there's uncertainty there, or any kind. So make sure that first you go see around if you can settle here or not, and then start bringing your family slowly. And it's always good to look around alone in compared to you are actually coming with the family, because then the pressure will increase. And also that first 90 days, you need to focus on your, can say kind of a re-study mode. So the best thing you should do that, come alone first.
Okay, great. Thanks. This all the informations will help people a lot. Next, going to the USA. Are you aware about the rules and regulations of USA?
Being part of SNMMI educators committee, I know a little bit, and not in detail, but everyone who joined nuclear medicine, the first thing they have learned that if you want to go to United States of America, you need to give an exam called NMTCB, Nuclear Medicine Technology Certification Board, which is actually their regulatory board's name is, and they run an exam. So you can find lots of resources related to preparation for the exam. Same process, that's no different than what.
So the first that exam.
First thing you need to apply. No, you need to start, first you apply. So that non-refundable fees will be there. Your application will be going to NMTCB. And again, they have a quite comprehensive application process where you need to provide lots of detail, like you'll be providing in MRTB here, all your education's qualification detail, from where you got, and if you've done a medical professional degree, then what's your clinical experience, what range of procedure you have done, what's your basic theory experience, what your syllabus was look like, how it was designed, how it was delivered, and then they evaluate, and then you will be getting an offer from NMTCB to appear for an exam. Now, in past, they used to have certain international centers, but thank you to COVID or any, all those IT people, COVID is coming secondary, IT people first. They changed a lot, like Zoom VR meeting. I'm also doing lots of online exam for my students as well. So you get a software like we use here. So same software will be like a robotic artificial intelligence agents, intelligence based. So you will be assessed online for NMTCB. And once your exam is clear, you will be okay to apply in any state. Now, remember, similar to Australia and US, there's a two things. It's similar in both countries. They have one state licenses, different state license, different state process. So they have regulatory committee, but they have a different state regulatory committee as well. And the second similar thing about both countries are that they will again ask you to do certain exams of the states as well. But that will be a minimal, but you can still start applying for the job. You can get the offer, but you can do that later on once you get the job. So this is what their process is in the United States. Salary, I think you will be coming straight on it. So I can tell you what the salary in United States of America is, that they have a band like in UK. So band one, band two, band three, band four. So they have a band for the initial one will be band. If you're coming with the experience of 3 to 4 years, obviously you'll be appointed as a band three to band four. And the
So our
salary is,
experiences, are counted there also.
Obviously,
Okay.
globally people are working from India. They've gone through like obviously lots of process of filtering and exam and all those stuff that everyone have to go. This is quite fair. And honestly, because I have worked back in India 11 years now, here 7 years, so I can clearly see the difference of how we work here. I'm not saying I'm undermining what I have learned or worked. That's why I'm here. But there are big difference in the approach. They lots of documentation we do, different way of approaching the patient. Like we have kind of a heart to heart touch with the. It's not like we are not emotionally attached with the patients or someone. But there's a professional way. You have to follow Privacy Act. You cannot discuss about the patient's things. You cannot even open your own report. I'm giving an example. If you are working in hospital, if you want to see your blood report, you will not be allowed. You have to go to the counter and say, this is what I want to look at it. So someone else look at it. If you will found doing this, you will be breach of you're actually breaking that breach, or this will be a kind of a reportable event. So there are lots of minor thing that we need to be careful about it. So I would say in small sentence, not take too much time, that you have the total approach is different. It's totally different way of working, protocols, manuals, quality control, lots of documentations. So those things are you can say we go with the line here, and sometime we don't follow or carry. Only the time when auditing comes, that time we follow. No, it's here, it's what you have to do, you have to do. And then auditing is quite frequent, 6 monthly audit, 1 year audit, your practice is audited. So be ready for those kind of things. This is not good. This is some for people, this is a shock, but if you start working in it, you start enjoying it. It's not shock. It is something which makes you better every time.
Yes. Okay. And
Have
I
I forgot
think,
about the salary of the states? I think I forgot.
yes, you said about the bands they follow, some
Yeah.
bands in
Yeah.
UK and USA. So.
I think the salary which I can tell you about a band 3 to band 4 is start from like US dollar, $75,000 to go up beyond that. 75 to 80 US is band 3, and then more than that. And depends in which state you are working. Again, I'm telling you, depends where you are, challenges are different. If you are in New York, whatever salary you're getting is one of the costly city of the world. So apartment will be costly. But if you are in California or Chicago, or you got the job, your center in some countryside of Peoria or somewhere, so it will be totally different cost of living. My brother-in-law, he used to live in Washington, D.C. Then he started living in Chicago. So he used that this all I never been, but he told me all these differences based on his experience. He's a software engineer, he's not a technologist, but he can understand and we can relate easily because a person will be living, human will be living in the houses, obviously.
True, very true. And what about Europe?
In Europe, I think the first and
You have
important
covered
thing,
already, and other countries.
Depends. Germany previously had the very big issue of the language barrier, because German you have to know, that was the criteria. But now they started getting a bit relaxed. Even if you're knowing fluent in English, they will consider
They
it.
allow.
Yeah, they allow. So I would say apply there. Ireland, I think the one of the option. Lots of medical profession go like nurses in Ireland a lot. I know 3 or 4 nurses who are working in Ireland who used to work with me in Indore. So they're over there. And then in Sweden, somebody can try. It's one of the very good country in Europe. That's I would say. They also have a similar law like Swedish Radiation Board. And then other
Here also we
country
need to
by
appear for the exam in the Sweden or in
yeah,
Ireland or
Ireland is actually consider experience. I don't know. But I know the one thing that they consider experience. What is your technical clinical experience post qualification and qualified from the you have a valid transcripts. again, it's like they have immigration will look at everything what you are giving, and they know each and everything. But your document should be good. So like somebody done from Mumbai University or Bhabha Atomics Center or Manipal, so they're all well known, you know, and even PGI Chandigarh or SGPI. But if somebody is doing from, I don't want to go in that detail, but there are some dodgy universities are there as well.
Yes.
So if somebody from there, then definitely somebody will look at it. So it's very important, I would say, be careful when you apply in Western countries. Make sure your qualifications and your all the transcripts are from real, show real picture, because that's not right. Because if you caught in that kind of situation, then you will not be able to apply anywhere. So this is something. So yeah, these are a few names. Germany, UK, we already know. And Ireland is something where people can look at the opportunity. Okay. And their salary is also, they paying in euros. So because UK is not euro, they pound. They've done the Brexit, bye-bye to European Union. So other countries have paying still in euro, and it's a good conversion actually.
Okay. And what about this English language test? Does our qualification only sufficient, or English language test like TOEFL and all, we need to undergo through? And what level they are asking for?
First, IELTS, you need to have, for New Zealand and Australia, they have IELTS, so IELTS, so that you have to get 7 or 7.5. That's a minimum 7.
7 is minimum, or 6.5 is the minimum?
7 is actually for the medical professional.
Okay.
For so 7 you must have. And for the TOEFL, I've never been to that zone, but yes, they still ask you to appear for that exam. And also, once you come here with your work visa and you want to stay here for longer, like you want to apply for a residency visa or permanent resident visa, so definitely they ask you to appear again and confirm that, yes, your band has not changed before applying for the residency visa. This rule came in 2019. Before that, it wasn't, if I'm aware of it. So this thing they bought before applying for the visa, even you have a year, 1 year or 2 years of experience, but still that is important.
Okay. Now coming to the Canada, what are the rules and regulations and procedure to go?
So Canada, again, CMRT, there's exam, Canadian Association of Medical Radiation Technologists, and their website is pretty much straightforward information. Again, you remember, one thing is common for all the Western world or all these countries, you have to apply with the expression of interest and what's your curriculum was, what you have learned, detail, and then you send your expression of interest with, say, this much of clinical hour I have, that's my detail, and send it to them. They will charge some money, which is in every single board is non-refundable. And then you will be getting an invitation to a given exam. And based on that exam, you will be get registered or non-registered. So this is the criteria. And they give, with one fees for CMRT, at least you get three times you can give it. So you can decide when you want to give that exam. And again, this online, and based on same that I was talking about, the software which monitor your activities. So this is the way they work.
Online option has become after the COVID only. Earlier, I think it was some offline exams in some cities they were conducting.
That's what I mentioned for the NMTCB
as
well.
That somewhere was also. Means people need not
yeah, obviously. But remember that if you, somebody who actually found doing cheating, then it's very easy to capture. So invigilation physical is not happening, but if you're giving an exam, for example, for 2 hours, you have to sit in front of the camera. You have to keep your monitor only just multiple choice question, and there's no descriptive, only MCQ based questions will be asked. And somebody who want to prepare for those sort of exams, then lots of resources available. There are a couple of private Christian developers, they are working there, so you can go and check their websites. And also CMRT also gives some paid link where you can use for doing the practice, or NMTC, we also have those options available. More you do the practice, more you will be able to come out of it. But remember, one thing is very important, because the theory, if somebody just go and start reading their basic books and all that, it's not that. It's all scenario based. Everything that question will be coming in your either REA or NMTCB or CMRT or all those registration exam, every single thing is based on scenario. You will be getting a scenario, clinical scenario, and how you're going to apply your knowledge, because they are not considering you as a fresher. That's why they're asking 3,600 clinical hours. So it means you are well to do in any challenging situation. Your decision making is good. So all those things, you need to be ready. So when somebody preparing, start thinking in the scenarios.
Okay. Roughly how many questions are there in 2 hours of exam?
Which exam are you talking about? CMRT, NMTCB, or REA, Australia, REA, New Zealand?
Yes, you can discuss all this. In a brief.
No, that's all right. So REA is actually mostly 200 questions. That's okay. What I know. And 2 hours.
In 2 hours.
So okay. In 2 hours. So basically the rule is, Divya, that 60 second we consider as for the one particular question. That 60 second for one question. So ideally 120, but 200 questions. So then previously they kept 2 hours, but now I heard as a half an hour extension is also applied there, just to give enough time. And all our multiple choice questions. And there is a very clear guide available about the RE exam, which keep updating every time, which shows that how many questions from which domain they will ask, how many questions they which domain they will ask, and what are their expectations. It's very clear. Like your general practice, your general radiation physics, radiopharmaceutical preparation, hot lab, radiation safety, PET CT, gamma camera. So what particular thing we are looking at it, and then the scenario based and straightforward question. There will be mix of things will be there. The question comes after a very good discussion from the professionals, and they just decide what question should be part of it. So yeah, this is what in the guide clearly mentioned, and is publicly available, freely available. You can find it. Google search RE exam guide. It is available. I would say your listener about the MRTB, CMRT and NMTCB, the similar type of approach. And recently there was a inclusion of the CT component, a little bit more question in these NMTCB was suggested last year. Being part of the one of the review committee, I actually found that lots of feedback came from the practitioners by increasing the PET CT or SPECT CT inclusion. Even in future, MRI will also come. So due to the hybrid imaging, they want that we should have a good knowledge of CT scanning.
Other modalities.
Like here, yeah. So I am done my theory exam clear from Charles Sturt University, Australia. Now I'm doing my clinical training. Although must be you have done whatever, but you have to go through certain logbook and you do that. So everyone, you have to go with the dual qualification, certain pathways. So they actually want for the nuclear medicine technologists who just applying for NMT, a CT component also should be checked. So they will be doing only gamma camera. For example, if I'm doing a PET CT, CT button I cannot press, like I cannot inject contrast. Or if I want to do, I have to take someone who is CT qualified radiographer.
Okay.
So yeah. So this is kind of similar for Australia, similar for US and Canada. You have to be registered as a dual qualified. So for that, we have to go through process. Like currently, I just finished my theory, as I mentioned, going through my practical training, and then we'll apply.
Is that rule applicable just now, or how? Because you are working for so long. So
no, that. So if you look at your qualification, Divya, if you done your nuclear medicine course, have you learned the CT?
No.
No. So CT is altogether a different part, you know, like
if you're doing PET CT, so CT has to be a part of that. So how have you
yeah.
managing it?
So basically, according to them, CT have different challenges, a different equipment, which is a part of your scanning process. Okay, so we know that we are doing and we are learning at our practice, but a qualification is important. Like when I done my theory training, it was easy for me because I'm teaching general radiography. So, and also I'm teaching radiation practice and all that other paper. So it was easy for me to read those textbook and apply that knowledge, but it's a totally different field. Like why are you doing portal venous? Why are you doing arterial? What is the hardware work? What dual energy X-ray works and how the multi-slice, single-slice CT works. So all those things, and then they evaluated in two different time period for 200 questions that we have answered. So then I realized, yes, this is something different. So here in Australia or in America, they have a 1 year separate for the CT. They teach them for two semesters. So they just want us to do the similar thing. So
now
I like
we
learned almost
three. Here also in the new syllabus of universities and courses.
That's a good thing.
Yeah, that has been introduced. But in our time, it was not there. When
no.
We studied, and it was not there. Yeah.
And absolutely, I'm agree with that. If you are only, because we qualified as a nuclear medicine technologist. So if I'm saying I'm a qualified as a CT, that's wrong. I have to learn that.
Yes.
It's not like that I don't know. I learned, I was doing CT while as a CT radiographer in, while I was working in India, and I used to go to do lots of emergency CT scan. I have that practical experience. But when you learn theory, that altogether different. Like X-ray radiographer, I tell you one example. General radiographer can do general X-rays, right? But mammography is a totally specialist field. So you have to do a post-graduation in mammography here to become a mammographer. And mammography is altogether different science. Your approach is different. Your patients are different. Patients are fragile. Machine is totally different. Obviously, they are using copper target to producing 25 to 35 keV electron energy X-rays. So you should know that. If you know general X-ray, you know mammography. But approach is different. And they said, no, you have to learn that in 3 years. That's a post-graduation.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think we have covered our all the discussions. And when we talk about nuclear medicine doctors, can you say something about that? Means what are their qualification requirements and what are their expected salaries and all those things, if we can discuss. Are you aware?
I'm honestly, I got these questions from a couple of doctors from India as well, while few of my colleague who was working, and then few whom I don't know, but I know they are still working in India. So basically for doctors, I will say, one thing need to understand about the nuclear medicine, we in New Zealand, if I say, we have radiologists who are reporting every single thing. And so there's no specifically nuclear medicine doctor qualification. This is totally different in America and Canada. And also in Australia, they have nuclear medicine qualified, but radiologists are dominating and they are taking care of all the reporting here of the nuclear medicine. Yeah. They are doing reporting of that.
But if we cannot press the button of CT, how can they report the PET?
Because they actually done their degree of Frenger. So that is called Radiological Society of Australia and New Zealand, and that's the college, and that teach them for ultrasound, CT, MRI, nuclear medicine, every single thing. And they spend, they be almost like 4 years post their graduation. So they are very well trained and they are doing really well. So we cannot argue with that.
Okay.
They are, after
sufficiently trained. Yeah. Okay.
Sufficiently, they are very good.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's no doubt in it. So anyone, and if I'm not allowed to press the button, because that's a law. It's not like I will be touching every single equipment because I know how to press it and how to handle.
I'm not talking about every button. I'm just talking about the PET CT button because the most of the part.
No, I'm saying that I'm doing PET CT, but the thing is that if I want to inject contrast. So that's actually in a general way I'm telling. If I want to inject the contrast, you know, is a life-threatening thing, okay?
Yeah.
So if I'm actually not a qualified CT radiographer, how
someone
I am allowed to do that?
Along with us. Someone
absolutely.
Should be
or
should be
otherwise.
Trained. Dual training.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So like
dual
after my...
Is allowed? Dual qualification?
Yes, that's what actually they're doing. So you will be getting dual registration.
Okay.
For example, even if you are a general radiographer, and you want to become a CT radiographer, so you already know the general physics, but you have to go through certain hours of trainings, that is 300 hours and few papers you have to do. So I think this is something which is kind of a, I think, more managed way to transforming your journey from one to another specialty, because it is not about pressing the button. It actually brings lots of responsibility. It, like you pressing the button and the patient is getting exposed. It's not fun. Yeah. It's not you got a BMW car and you got a, yes, I'm ready to drive it because I know drive how to Mitsubishi Suzuki or whichever car. It's actually having some responsibility.
Yes.
So that's why this is actually important. Now we come back to your question of radiologists and the nuclear medicine doctor. So they are all trained from the French Fréjeur. I give you a full name of it because I always keep their website open. It's very good. Yeah, so that's called Fréjeur. And the full form of the Fréjeur is, it's called Fréjeur, but they, it's www.fréjeur, and it comes under the Royal Australian and New Zealand College of Radiologists. And basically their process is that if you want, if you are a qualified MBBS doctor, you've done your MD or DNB in nuclear medicine, still you have to apply for a registration exam to respective board, whether New Zealand or Australia. And then you have to work, once you pass that exam, I think it's a 4,000 NZ dollar, 4,000 or 4,500, that's some fees in between. And then you will be practicing as a registrar under the any senior at a certain time period, like 6 months to 1 year. Also, they ask you to do one of the paper that is public health science. And the paper is provided by University AUT from where I am doing, and also University of Auckland. So they all actually ask you to do a postgraduate diploma in public health science, and which actually will help you to understand local laws, locals, you know, approach. As I mentioned, similar journey, but different paper they have to do as well. And once you're done, you finish 2 years of your registrarship along with that paper, you've done a kind of a bridge course, you cross that bridge, and then you will be doing, then you need to apply for Fréjeur, that is Radiology Society, the Royal College of Australia and New Zealand, and then you will be trained. And after that, you qualified as a radiologist. Listen to that word, which I want to clarify here, that you asked about that CT PET thing. Then you will be get trained under nuclear medicine doctor. And you need to finish at least 2 years of supervised reporting under them, under the radiologist. So few of them are qualified. And then we have certain specialty doctor who got qualified in the SPECT CT. They are specialists. Someone are only musculoskeleton specialist. Someone who is actually only specialist in the oncology. Someone is only in the renal. So those specialization also you can do along with. So it's like a, not very complex, but it is a bit complex. It seems like you can see that when I'm from where I'm explaining it.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
So this rule will be applicable to everybody irrespective of the seniority of in the profession.
Absolutely. That's why I always say to...
They have to undergo this, be as a registrar and then go for the 1 year and then these all the things.
I remember one statement, Divya, that when somebody asked me who was very senior, I said it will be quite... disheartening for you because you are very senior, and when you have to work in that way. And even I actually give an email ID of few of the radiologists who originate got their qualification in India, and then they went to UK and done their diploma in radiology, and then they came to New Zealand, work in Australia, and then came to New Zealand. So their journey was like too long. And they mentioned clearly to me that it is very hard for someone who is already practicing and getting good bucks, because salary-wise, if you say, then, as I mentioned, it will be definitely handsome salary will come in your mind, but it's not lesser than what they are currently getting in India. Okay, so I would suggest, somebody asked me, I don't discourage doctors to come, but I say, if you want to come for a holiday, then come. Otherwise, if you really want to work here, then be ready for a little bit of that journey. Because honestly, country have their rules and you have to follow. It's not like they're not considering, because medical professions, medical qualifications, especially for the doctors, are very, very arranged. And we can say it's quite follow the international norms. And instead of coming to New Zealand, you can apply in Australia. They have a certain straightforward process, but not guarantee that you will be working in the same field that you are currently practicing in. You might have to select something else. I know one of the doctor who was working in the neurosurgery, and then he moved to state, and he was actually currently still working as a GP. So it is something which is different, and I don't want to comment on it, but they have certain criteria. And I really don't, I never been to that kind of detail. I'm telling you what I know, you know, surface detail.
Yeah. But for the radiologist, I think it is a pretty simpler. I think because you said first they need to undergo as a registrar under some radiologist, and then under some nuclear medicine physician, and then they need to work as a independent nuclear medicine practitioner.
First exam they have to clear. First the exam. So remember those steps. First exam, which is medical council. Exam they have to clear. Following by that, they will apply for some course from the public health science. This is another way as well. You know, and one way you can come to this country by applying for the education. So there is a, as I mentioned, public health science post-graduation. Somebody can apply for that course, and that will give you a entry, and you can then apply as a registrar after your 2 year qualification. There's a 1 year qualification, the 2 year qualification. You can do whichever. 2 year qualification is better, the master's one, and it's quite costly, remember, because international student pay 5 times fees more than the local student. So your fees will be quite higher, like $28,000 to $35,000 for one of the semesters. So it will be quite costly. Yes. You can consider. Yeah. So be ready for that expenses. Along with that, you'll be staying and, you know, lodging and all that thing. So that's another way. So it is depend on someone who is really ambitious, then they can come. And another thing I would like to advise, instead of me, I'm not an expert in that. There are a lot of recruitment agencies for the doctors. They are available. They just are type recruitment agency for medical doctor in Australia and New Zealand. So they have a very good practical experience. They know some pathways. They tell you that, okay, this is the shortcut. Might be because I'm not updated about it. So best thing you should tell that you go and contact them. They can even provide some holiday jobs, and they can tell when the registration exam, how to apply. So recruitment agencies work together with the those people who are looking for the qualified medical professional. I would suggest them to do Google about that, and they will find some good amount of recruitment agencies.
I think for the doctors, the Gulf countries is an easy option rather than going to the Western countries.
Absolutely. They just take you right away, and you can earn good bucks and come back and run your own hospital.
Yes. So that is the good option. And what about the rules, regulations? We have spoke about nuclear medicine technologists or the physicists. Are the same for the other radiographers, CT technologists? And I think it would be the same for the other medical radiation professionals as a technologist.
So remember, nuclear medicine physicist word that we use in India, I know it's a controversial, and then we came up with that journey and trying to be, I'm not against that. But I qualified as a nuclear medicine technologist. Physicist is someone who is a master's in physics and do their diploma in radiation physics. So their journey is different. Their knowledge of physics is different than us. And they have a big, a more big picture in compared to us. So I'm not discouraging. We know equal to them about our nuclear medicine field. So nuclear medicine physicist word, if we use, then there is a separate qualification here for the medical physicist. And they do in University of Canterbury, University of Sydney also provide. And there is a very long process to get that designation. So this is something which we, I don't want to comment on that part. How we will be treated, this is something which you would like to, this is what your question is like, how the difference between the general MRTs and NMT. So NMTs are always special, you know. We are currently celebrating Nuclear Medicine Week. So we are something already a special children of radiology because we do everything. We do CT, we do MRI because PET MRI is there, then we do nuke med. So that's why a special treatment, if I say, then special, I don't know whether we get every day, every week, some chocolates, but yeah, some special the things that you I cannot declare online, but few things which are literally different in the terms of CME allowances. Otherwise, there is a no up and down. Like, we all are same here. MRTs are MRT. And honestly, I'm telling you, Divya, that now I'm teaching AMR medical radiation course from last 3.5 years. And I can tell you, general MRT who actually get qualified in 3 years, their knowledge, what they gain during this journey, and then they become a nuclear. I know someone who's actually now doing nuclear medicine, who's my student from University of Auckland. Their knowledge, what they learn every time, that is something which is really, we can say, yes, this is what actually, this is why the 3 years degree meaning is, why the process is so complicated for the overseas people. So they are very good. Honestly, I know a few MRTs who are, they're very good. I know from three of my senior lecturers, they are MRT from London. They, if I, whenever I sit down with them and I learn a lot, maybe my knowledge is lesser than my colleague NMT, then I get fascinated more, or whatever the assumption can be put in this, but different approach, different way. So that's why there is a no special, you are NMT and you are MRI technologies or mammographer, nothing. They're all actually similar. So we don't have any issue. Salaries are, you know, always, this is what your question? This is what your question is?
My question was for the entry level, the qualifications.
So cut it.
For the entry level, the qualifications and the process of entry is same for all the medical radiation professionals.
Absolutely. BSc in the general radiation science. That's what I'm saying. I think I answered your question then correctly. Yes. That we are all coming from the same part. Medical radiation science graduation, same pathway. Yeah. Then in your, after 3 years, you decided to go to mammography or MRI or CT or nuke med. Then you do your 4.5 year post-graduation. So you see the long journey, 8 and 7.5 year journey.
7.5 year sub journey. And then you can be working there. As
yeah, absolutely. And the qualification required lots of, you know, it's a different way of assessing people. Like in master's, level 7, level 8, we call level. So level 5, level 6, level 7. So different papers have different expectations, different academic requirements, different writing expectation. And when you comes to the master's, you do your thesis, a small dissertation there. And so I think it's altogether different approach. Student, when they do the graduation here, they do 2 publication in journals. In the master's, they do 3 or 4 publication in journals. So that is something which is a different type of approach, I would say. And so all are similar, honestly. There is no difference. You can learn from each other. So there's no up and you are better on that. Yes, we do a little bit of show off that they're doing radiation science. Yay, we have a open radiation, all that. But everyone is good in their field. Yeah.
Thanks. I think I have covered all my questions. It was very nice talking to you. And it was really an honor to have you on my channel. Thanks a lot.
Oh, thank you, Divya, for inviting. And I hopefully I try to answer all the questions based on my knowledge. But thanks for inviting. It was really exciting talking to you. And namaste to everyone in India, because and everyone who is coming from India, and I say they are alone and nobody is there in New Zealand. So don't worry. I actually like being part of one of the Indian origin technologists who came from the other part of the world. But it was easy for him to settle in. So if somebody is coming, somebody want to contact me, no problem. My LinkedIn or from here, if they would like to know, they can email me. I'm always available to help whatever I can.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Namaste. Namaste.